If you're building a website, chances are pretty high that you'll need some kind of overlays on that website. For example, a modal, maybe a dropdown, maybe some toast messages. Overlays are everywhere. Chances are also pretty high that you're building them like a caveman, that you're still writing your own JavaScript code or you're using some library, but you don't have to because you can use the Popover API. The Popover API is a relatively new browser API which has amazing browser compatibility. All major browsers support it, so it's ready for production use today. And the Popover API makes building and managing modals or dropdowns or toast messages like this a breeze with no or only a bare minimum of JavaScript code required. Now, this video here is part of a little mini series where I take a look at a couple of pretty amazing modern browser and CSS features that are ready for production use today because they have great cross-browser support, but that still aren't used by that many people. Also because AI doesn't really know about them. I want to change that, at least for you, and you can then change it for AI, and therefore let's now take a look at the Popover API. So here I'm in that example project, and you also find that below, of course, attached so that you can take a look at it yourself. And the code for this is super simple. If we take a look at the index.html file here, when it comes to this first modal, this here is the relevant code. And that's all. No JavaScript code needed. Instead, we got our button that opens the modal, so that's the trigger. This button has the popover target attribute, which is part of the popover API, so it's a special attribute. And the value of this attribute is popover modal in this case, but it could be anything because it's simply the name of the ID of the element that contains the content that should be opened as an overlay. So in this case here, this div. So I'm pointing at this div essentially and saying, hey, please open this div as an overlay whenever this button here is pressed. That's all that's happening here. Important though, this div also must have the popover attribute now. So we have popover target on the trigger and popover on the content. And then we also connect trigger and content with the ID. And that is all. Again, no JavaScript code needed. I do have some CSS code though to style this modal, of course, but in the end it's just standard CSS, maybe except for a few tiny details. For example, the popover open pseudo class, the pseudo selector here. This is added by the browser or becomes active by the browser automatically when that popover opens. And you can use it to style the popover content in the open state. And you can, for example, also use it to have a little entry animation. So here I set the opacity to 1 and the scale and translate y to the actual end values I want to have. But I then also use the starting style CSS rule, which is also relatively new, to set a starting style for this open state, which deviates from that final state. Here I set opacity to 0 and have some other transform values. And that in the end leads to that nice entry transition, which is played automatically because I have my transition property on the popover modal and I have transition set up for opacity and transform. That is how the entry animation works. This popover doesn't just have an entry animation though, it also has a nice dismissal exit animation, and that is achieved by animating or by transitioning the display property with allow discrete. Allow discrete is also a relatively new CSS feature which you can use on display transitions, for example, and this simply tells the browser that it should wait with the removal of this element from the DOM, or with actually, hiding it, so to say, that it should wait with that until that transition is done. That's the simple way of putting it. And that is exactly what you need to animate the exit of this element. Because we also have opacity 0 and the transform styles as set up here on the popover modal itself, so that is what it will animate to when it gets rid of the popover open class, which it does get rid of once you start closing it. So that is how that exit animation is implemented. And then, also interesting, we got the backdrop pseudo element, which is also managed by the browser because the browser does not just open that overlay for you, it also gives you a backdrop, which you can style by targeting this backdrop pseudo element here. And then again, here you can also achieve an entry animation with a starting style and so on, and an exit animation as well if you want to. So that's the CSS styling, but when it comes to just managing that popover, that overlay, it's just HTML. Now for this popover here, another important attribute is the popover target action attribute, which you can find on this button, which is inside of the popover content. There, I also have popover target pointing at the actual overlay element of which this button is part of. But I do that in order to make this button close the popover because it's my close button. And to get it to close it instead of open it, which would be the default, I add the popover target action attribute, which is another attribute that's part of the popover API, and set that to hide. The alternatives would be show if I wanted to show it, but of course that's not what I want here for the close button, or toggle to do the opposite of what's currently the case. So show it if it's hidden, hide it if it's shown. But here it should always hide, so I set it to hide. And it's the same for this dropdown, for example. It looks different, but here again, it's still a button with popover target and then action menu as an ID, which is the ID on that div, which is the content of the dropdown. And then on that content, we also have popover. And again, it's no JavaScript code. Again, we do have some CSS code involved, and it's essentially the same as before, just without a backdrop, because I don't need a backdrop here. But what's interesting about this CSS code is the position anchor property. This is also a relatively new CSS feature, which unfortunately is not yet supported by all major browsers by the point of time I'm recording this. Firefox is not supporting it yet. And the idea behind this property simply is that it simplifies the process of visually attaching one element to another. It works like this. You define an anchor name, which is related to the position anchor property, on the element you want to attach another element to. So in this case, that's my menu trigger, which simply is this button here. That is the anchor name. And then position anchor targets that anchor name and therefore tells the browser, hey, this element, the menu popover, which is the content of the dropdown menu, that should be visually attached to that anchor name element, so to the trigger, to this button. And that is how we have this attachment here. Now, when it comes to the toast notifications, I do actually use some JavaScript code, but in the end, really just to dynamically create those toast messages. So here in the HTML code, we got no popover target or anything like that. Instead, I got some JavaScript code down here where I have my event listener, where I call show toast, which is this function, my own function. In that function, I call create toast, which is also my own function, this one here. And in this function, I simply create a div, I give it a class name for styling and so on. And very important, I add the popover property, which is the equivalent to the popover attribute just in JavaScript now. Also important, on that property, I set a value of manual. And before, with the popover attribute, I did not set any values. The reason for that is that we could have set this to auto, which is the default value. But since it's the default, you don't need to set it. Now, what's the difference, you rightfully ask? With auto, the idea is that if you have a popover of type auto open, if some other popover appears on a page, that first popover closes. So this dropdown closes as soon as I emit a toast. But as you might notice, I can have multiple toast messages, even though every single one of them is a popover. And that is the case because of manual. With manual, you can have multiple popovers at the same time. But those manual popovers will dismiss auto popovers. As you see, the dropdown closes when I emit toasts. That's the entire idea here. Besides that, the only difference is that I programmatically open and hide this popover with the show popover and hide popover methods, which are provided by the browser. And other than that, the browser still manages all the rest, ensures accessibility, that it's on the highest possible visual level, and all that fun stuff. Now, for the tooltip here, I can hover over this to show the popover because it's not restricted to clicks. Instead, you can also listen to mouse enter and mouse leave for hover effects and use that to show or hide a popover, which is exactly what I'm doing here. Interesting about this popover is, if we take a look at the HTML code, which is where I'm setting it up, that I don't have a popover target here because, again, I trigger that programmatically, but I do have the popover attribute set on the actual content that should be shown as an overlay. So you can mix and match programmatic and a declarative setup. But here I set that to the hint value. So not auto, not manual, but hint. The idea behind hint is that, like manual, multiple popovers can be open at the same time, but that we also don't close auto popovers. So where the dropdown would close if I emit a toast, it does not close if I hover over this button. It stays open. That's the difference between manual and hint. Both are about having multiple popovers, but hint does not close auto popovers. Now, kind of related to the popover API is the dialog element, which is also part of the browser. The dialog element can also be used to show a modal. What's the difference, though? The difference is that the dialog element-driven modals capture the user's focus and attention. You can't dismiss them by clicking the backdrop. That's one of the main differences. The modal that was created with the popover API can be dismissed by clicking the backdrop, just as this dropdown can be closed by clicking anywhere else. The modal opened with the dialog element can only be closed by interacting with the buttons, and then it simply depends on how you configured the buttons, which code is triggered when you click those buttons, or with the escape key, but not by clicking the backdrop. Now, I do show and hide this dialog modal here programmatically in this case by simply getting hold of my dialog, and then I have event listeners on the different buttons to show the modal or to close it. So it's not show popover and hide popover, but instead show modal and close on the dialog element. So the dialog element supports these methods to programmatically show or hide them. Now, since the dialog is not technically part of the popover API, it doesn't have that special popover open pseudo class. Instead, it has an open attribute that's added whenever it's open. So you can use that for styling the open state and, for example, adding an animation. And it does have that same backdrop, which you can use for styling the backdrop and also adding an animation to that if you want to. And that's therefore how you can control overlays with the popover API and or dialogs. And as you see, only a minimal amount of JavaScript code is needed, if at all, and you get all these benefits like better better accessibility, guaranteed visibility on the highest possible level without writing your own JavaScript code. So the next time you're building a website and you need some kind of overlay, using the Popover API or the dialog element might be worth your time.